God's light. Peter approached Jesus and asked him, Lord, if my brother sins against me, how often must I forgive him? As many as 7 times. Jesus answered, I say to you, not 7 times, but 77 times. That is why the kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who decided to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the accounting, a debtor was brought before him owed a large amount. Since he had no way of paying it back, his master ordered him to be sold, along with his wife, his children, and all his property, in payment of the debt. At that, the servant fell down, and in homage, and said, be patient with me, and I will pay you back in full. Moved with compassion, the master of that servant let him go, and forgave him the loan. When that servant had left, he found one of his fellow servants, who owed him a much smaller amount. He seized him and started to choke him, demanding, pay back what you owe. Falling to his knees, his fellow servant begged him, be patient with me, and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he had the fellow servant put to the prison until he paid back the debt. Now, when his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were deeply disturbed, and went to their master and reported the whole affair. His master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you your entire debt because you begged me to. Should you not have had pity on your fellow servant as I had pity on you? Then in anger, his master handed him over to the torturers until he should pay back the whole debt. So will my heavenly Father do to you, unless each of you forgives his brother from his heart. When Jesus finished these words, he left Galilee and went to the district of Judea across the Jordan. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you.
Everything the Lord did and taught could fill a book. In fact, most of it did. But the book itself says that if everything were to have been written down, all the books of the world couldn't hope to contain it. The story of the gospel we have in its essentials, we have in its fullness, and yet it's a fullness that admits of a deeper discovery, reflection upon what has been handed on to us. And so when Peter asks Christ, how often must he forgive his brother as many as 7 times? 7 implying the fullness. Do I have to keep forgiving as long as it's reasonable? Christ answers not 7 times, but 77 times. The idea that it's not just a reasonable amount, but reason compounded by reason compounded by a full measure and number. That is why the kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who desired to settle accounts with his servants. This idea that we have to continually be ready to extend forgiveness to one another. This had its issues, though. And maybe yourself, though, of times where you've forgiven a neighbor, perhaps on something fairly serious, like major fraud or extortion or adultery or what have you, some major sin. And your forgiveness, instead of being seen as a new start, becomes a way of overlooking it or not confronting it. At least that's the way it can sometimes be regarded. And the early church was very sensitive to this. The idea that sinners could be readmitted back to communion through penance, something that is described in the Didache, some of the earliest texts of the church that command us to confess our sins to one another. But there wasn't emphasis even then on how there comes a point where forgiveness, the whole dynamic by which forgiveness is sought, breaks down. And so there were varying interpretations. Some would say that murder and adultery couldn't be forgiven in life, that at the deathbed you would bring the sacraments to the person and reconcile them, that you can immediately see the downside of such an arrangement. It encourages people to wallow in sin, and it assumes that you can get to them at the last minute, which isn't always the case. You had those who were prepared to say, well, you can confess once and be forgiven. But if you fall back into something as serious as adultery or idolatry, there's no way the church can forgive you a second time. And there are texts in the letter of the Hebrews that talk about how if we turn aside from the forgiveness we've been granted, how awesome and terrible a thing it is that we've turned away from the very means by which we can be forgiven. The idea there not being that forgiveness is subsequently impossible, but that it's incredibly difficult. Our saints today, Pontian and Hippolytus, are an interesting example that brings to the fore what exactly Christ has in mind when he says you need to be ready to forgive 77 times. was actually a claimant to the papal throne. He was an anti-pope, the first anti-pope. And he came about at a time when there struggles had been conceived of how he would even describe that development. But he was backed by the party that argued for more rigor, more scrutiny, more discernment in admitting people back, in making sure that their penance held. Pontian was not his immediate competitor as the true pope, but he was the heir from Pope Calixtus, who was. And his party, which proves to be the Orthodox and Triumphant Party, is that the church has the authority to forgive sin time and time again, 77 times. And that this does not undermine the dynamic of forgiveness, though there are times in your professional where you might have to be a little hard on someone, welcoming them and trying to build them up, but also saying, you know, it's presumptuous to even this path. There are times when one might need to say that. But the church does have that authority. And God has given the church that authority, not to hold it over sinners, but to admit them to the fullness of forgiveness, even if they should struggle along the way, to keep them on the way, even if they continue to sin time and time again. The schism that Hippolytus became part of, the Novatian schism, had the line from their founder, Novatian, who would say, even if God could forgive this sin, the church cannot. The idea being, he wasn't opposed to the idea that repeat adulterers or others who committed these serious sins would be incapable of reconciliation, but he thought it had to wait till the end of life. But we know from the example that Christ sets in this story that we have to be ready to extend that forgiveness time and time again. Forgiveness is not mean forgetting. It doesn't mean pretending as if the thing done didn't happen. It doesn't mean that you necessarily treat the person the same. If someone trashed your car, you need not give them the keys a second time, necessarily. But it does mean that we have to give them the space to exceed our expectations. We have to give them the chance, on whatever level, to be seen as worthy and loved in our sight and in the eyes of the church. I don't know how many of you saw the movie Silence, recounting the same novel with that title. It was a Martin Scorsese movie maybe about 4 years ago that it came out. And it recounts the Jesuit martyrs in Japan working with and reconciling the indigenous Catholic population that was under considerable persecution, and the Japanese authorities who made it their mission and goal to put the Christians through such miserable situations that they would apostatize, that they would renounce their faith because of the psychological duress and pain was so much. And they were quite successful in getting those momentary missions fulfilled. There's one character in the movie who continually lapses. He's a coward. And every time he's put on the spot, he betrays whoever he's with him. But then within short order, you'll hear him saying, Father, I need to go to confession. Father, I need to go to confession. And this was taken by the many audience goers and thankfully by the filmmakers themselves as a moment of comic relief, as something that would almost be incongruous or strange, that the scholar could betray so readily and continually turn back to the Lord, that there was something compromised and even comical about it. Now, indeed, he is deeply compromised. He is a bit of a walking contradiction. But the friars who went to the movie and reported it back to me were not amused, because that's the very opposite of the tenor that Christ sets here, that the church sets in administrative standard. Every sin makes us a walking contradiction. And rather than humble and humiliate those who find themselves in that place, we are meant to walk with, to bear with, and to help transform the lives of those who are found that way. So any sin can be forgiven, and it can be forgiven time after time. And this is shown finally and most principally in this piece, in how Pontian and Hippolytus, both of the anti-pope, were reconciled. They were reconciled and they were deported to Sardinia, put into a slave mining camp, and both were worked to death there. That even to put yourself up as pope, even to resist the full measure of forgiveness to others, does not preclude reconciliation, does not preclude true unity in God's truth and forgiveness. And the two of them, though opponents in much of their careers, were indeed reconciled in the full measure that Christ had in mind. Whether that's seven conversations or 77, I do not know. But it almost certainly took more than one.
Thank you.
the mystery of faith. Save us. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants, your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty the gifts that you have given us, this pure group, this holy group, this spotless group, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Please look upon these offerings, to screen and have the Catholic sons, to accept them as once you please, to accept the gifts of your servant, the holy trust, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father, and the offering of your life, his name, a holy sacrifice, as God. In humble prayer, we ask you all, and then the gifts be borne by the hands of the holy angels, to your altar online, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, by this visitation, and you all can receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and every blessing through Christ our Lord. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest and sleep. Grant that, O Lord, we pray, and all this to place the life of life and peace in Christ our Lord. To us also your servants who those sinners, hope in your love and mercies. Graciously grant us share of fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, our survivors, Peter, Felicity, Hephaestus, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, and Anastasia, and all your saints. They bid us to receive you into their family, not waiting on our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord. Through whom we continue to name all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify, build them, life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, and formed by the Holy Spirit, we dare to say,
Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of God. have received this heavenly sacrament, O Lord, as we commemorate your saints, Pontian and Hippolytus.